Senator Shacklet.
Thank you, Senator. A lot of you folks know who I am, former chair of the planning committee. I know you and State Representative Johnson, who are the deputy secretary of planning. And I was wondering if it was made as a utilization of the state and the commission. Somehow or another, the leaders don't hear the state or our private area. Somehow that directly and outside of the state. That's why.
Well, there's a few issues that you raised, and just to give you an update, Joel may have some additional information on that. One of the things the legislature and the governor worked on, I would say, probably a month before the end of the session, was really trying to improve the bill maintenance so that we make sure that the state is paying its financial obligations to counties and communities. And we made a lot of progress on that, so that has been significantly improved right at the end of session. So I that's some good news, and I don't have a specific dollar amount for you in Gladwin County, but I think you'll be pleased to know that, and that's a priority. Now, it's a much greater priority, I will tell you, for people and those of us who represent districts in northern Michigan. Sometimes it's harder to emphasize the importance of that to our colleagues from the southern, more populated counties. But that has been a significant improvement. On the access issue, and I know Joel is very involved in this, Keith Cray is the new director for the DNR. He actually came up and did a horseback ride in the Pigeon River Forest and kind of to understand the issue better, and you know, because you have these competing interests. And so I can't tell you that there's been a final resolution to everyone's satisfaction, but I will say that we have his ear. He's assigned different people. We had a meeting in Gladwin and the county, and had a chance to talk to some of the trainers, dog trainers, and then the horse enthusiasts. And so I think we're working towards solutions, but it certainly is a significant concern, and I think the good news is the director has probably been more engaged than I've seen any director in the past, and so I think that's a real positive.
Senator Casperson is still the chair.
Yes, Senator Casperson chairs the Natural Resources Committee in the Senate. Did we name the House Committee? Okay. And he has a certain understanding of this better than most. You know, he certainly with the horse issues, but also being from the UP, you know, this idea of how much land should the state own, what are the priority rankings, and how should we resolve those kinds of issues. He's a real leader on that. Yeah.
John, I sit on the Workforce Development Board, and one of the problems that you have is the high cost of getting people back into the workforce, particularly when they drop out of school or have other barriers to being involved in the workforce. Of course, the state has taken the direction that all of our students are headed towards college, and as a result, we have a dropout rate that's probably in the area of about 50% that never wind up completing. One of the things I think should be directed is that, and we allow kids to drop out of school, and we put a little penalty that they can't get their driver's license, but the real impact is that we should look at those kids when they come to that decision point and say, you can't drop out of school at 16. We will send you, and if you can't operate in the school environment, we'll send you to a technical training. And since the state is willing to pay that $7,000 to get them educated through high school, why not send them to the MTech, get them welding training or nurses training or some job-specific training where at least we prepare them for entry into society rather than being a grad. And I think that that's one of the things that the legislature could do to try to address a problem in the state of Michigan. Obviously, one of the big things that gets bandied about is the more educated people that you have in a state, the better the state winds up doing. So if we can wind up at least getting them technical education, they'll wind up being better prepared to be citizens in the state of Michigan. Other than that, I don't need you to fix any other problems.
Thank you. You know, just I wanted to address that, and Caroline, did you want to add to that? Because we have Carol Churchill here, and got Scott Philbitch here, so you know, that's an important thing, and I think we got that wrong when a lot of the graduation requirements, I know Joel's been working on this, you know, we kind of had a cookie-cutter approach, and one of the areas that was limited is sort of the CTE courses for people who are interested in skilled technical careers. And when you look at the job opportunities, and I always hear a number and don't know sometimes what the source of that number, but someone told me the other day that there are job openings for like 400 machinists in the region. And you've got people, you know, not working, and then suddenly, you know, there's certain fields where there's opportunities. And we've got to get better as a state at I think our community colleges a great job helping position people towards where there are opportunities in the workforce. Because I've never believed that if you go to a four-year institution and you graduate in a field where there's no jobs, I mean, there is some value in studying hard and you know, going through the hoops that you have to do to get a four-year degree, but if there's not an opportunity at the end of the day and you're in a job that doesn't even use that, so you can support your family. That, there's a real disconnect there. And so I do think we need to get better at that. I know the governor's going to be giving an address on sort of talent and education in March and April, because it's definitely on his radar screen. You know, they've developed a website. You guys may look at this frequently, but kind of where the opportunities are for people. And so I think making that connection between the workforce preparation, educating people for the opportunities that are there, you know, we have a real opportunity to strengthen that. I think it's important, and thanks for raising the issue. Yeah, everyone here, then later.
You all first kind of told those to try to say something.
Yes.
I can say it, but they won't get the company. I'm an IRP, so I'm a little bit better than what I'm doing. But one of the things that we have found is that there is a conception amongst parents welder. You're an illusion, you know much of your welder, you need to know. The fact is, there's technical things that I talked about, the nurses, the welder, the machines. These are not things that you are an eighth grade dropout. You can walk in and have the skills to do those things. Factory setting of 1953, when you can walk off the street and get a job at GM in 2 minutes, isn't there. They want many people before they hire you. They need to be pretty smart.
Absolutely. And some of the financial reports over here as far exceed, you know, a lot of other careers. And, you know, there's a proverb that says, see a man skilled in his work and he will serve before kings. And I think there's something about that. When you really do well and have some skills that are needed. It's unfortunate that that perception is out there. I think that's changing. You know, was it Mike, who's the guy that speaks, Mike Rowe. You know, he's done an excellent job really communicating that message about his dignity of work with your hands, and the opportunities, you know, the skill trades, and I think there needs to be more of that now. You know, one last thing, probably the biggest trend that I've seen in the last year in education is more and more people are talking about project-based learning. And this idea that the more students connect what they're learning with real-life situations, examples, hands-on, not just the project at the end of the semester, but the kind of learning about a topic through going through a project. You know, I think that will reach a lot of students who have kind of tuned out of the traditional methodology in education, and I think we're going to see more of that.
Great.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
When are we here? We talked about road taxes.
Yes.
And you asked people to raise their hand when you agree to a road tax increase.
Yeah.
And over 3/4 of the people in that room at that time said yes. And I haven't seen anything happen in the last year on road taxes. Now, I would say this body is becoming the bottom of the state. If they want the taxes increased to have better roads or better job facilities to have to transport their goods around, it would be a good idea for you to take the mandate that we gave you last year and do something with it.
Well, I, you know, I will tell you, different people feel differently about that issue. You know, one of the topics we had at this table over here was, you know, on the news, on the way up, on the radio, Tim Scooting, who's kind of the Lansing reporter, you know, he has a scoop on what the governor's going to say in the state of the state, and one of the things he said was that he thinks the governor's going to propose increasing the registration will be $125.
That's in-state type of situation. Well, they appreciate 10 bucks to wear that type of deal. People from out of state that we act on pure Michigan to come and visit here, yeah, use our road. Yeah. Let them buy, yeah, buy in this state, yeah, and pay the road tax that they're on.
Yeah.
That's what we need to do.
And that's, you know, one of the arguments, you know, about increasing, you know, fuel taxes is that they do get people out of state for paying. There's always the question of this direction we're going, where fuel is more expensive, cars are becoming more fuel efficient. Is that the best, most stable way to fund our roads? I would say probably the consensus developing now would probably move away from that model, just because it may be a diminishing kind of thing. But you know what? Transportation was definitely on the governor's agenda and trying to fund infrastructure will definitely be at the forefront of this session's debates. I will tell you that there's not a consensus on many different proposals are out there, different ideas, and
chance to do something, you haven't done anything.
The legislature hasn't done one thing about roads that have come out of Lansing in the news that you've done anything. Like you said, registration, that's in-house. I'm talking about the people that come in and use our roads out of state or out of country. And you know, people coming in and forth from Canada.
Okay, yes, sir.
Just so we have a grasp on things, you have on top of your head how much is in fuel tax right now, and that will generate. I drive less because the cost of gas is so expensive. Raise the price of gas more, I'll drive even less, because my budget is going so much. So do you have an idea how much?
You know, I don't have the exact number, but I will tell you, one of the misconceptions is, people think that when gas prices increase, somehow there's more road money to come in. That's not the case. We just have fixed it now. And so, when gas prices increase, that actually hurts the roads, because people drive less, there's more fuel efficiency vehicles that people get, and as a result, there's plenty of emissions. And that's why it's not considered.
We've got next, the state gas tax is basically a fixed 19 cents per gallon, which has been that way since 1997. And county road commissions only get like 6 cents out of the 19 cents. And that's basically spread out based on miles and the formula, number of primary roads, local roads, stuff like that. But like I said, that's been fixed for, you know, quite a few years. And our revenue from the gas tax has been pretty flat for 10 or 12 years. So.
And there are different roads coming in. I was just going to say, the other thing we have to remember is that we also have 6% sales tax on our fuel, which makes our taxes high on our fuel, but higher than most states, but very little of it goes to road funding.
Right.
So that goes to general fund. That's something that we need to address.
We talked about road tax. We talked about going to road only. That's the part. You were talking about anything different from sales tax than that. Specifically, a 3-cent tax on road money only. That was what we talked about, and I hadn't heard of it.
Yeah, well, that's in the back. That's in the back. Yeah. Somewhere where you analyze, and then you have to invest, you're going to go somewhere where appreciated and not valued. So that's one that, for more industrial jobs. For small businesses, eliminating the Michigan business tax was a huge step forward for them, and gives them more freedom to hire people. Now, we don't mandate that they have to hire people, but it gives them the opportunity to have some more ability to hire if they have the opportunity. So those are two. The other lever you have is regulatory reform, which says, you know, what are we doing in state government that is really restricting people from investing here or expanding here? You know, I think the governor has really set a good tone when he talks about customer service. Now, that's been a real, you know, coming from the private sector, customer service was a big thing in his business background. You know, I've seen a difference in how the departments view Michigan residents as customers and trying to be cooperative. You know, it used to be that the DEQ kind of had an attitude of, that basically appreciated it. You know, it was kind of an attitude of, we know you're doing something wrong and we're going to find out. You know, and I don't mean that in a way. You know, they've got a tough job. But there is a way to say, okay, we're going to enforce the law. We're going to make sure that people who are bad actors, you know, have consequences. But we're also going to try and find out how we can get to a solution when there's a problem. Somebody wants to invest in Michigan. How can we get to a position where they can actually accomplish their goals? You know, it's good for the state and, you know, still work within the rules. So I've seen a dramatic change. It used to be everywhere I go, the DEQ was the number one. Everybody familiar about the DEQ, you know, I don't hear that really a lot. And, you know, it's not, things are perfect. But I think the governor is setting a good tone and his directors are implementing that. So that's another area. You know, I know you probably followed, and I think we took a poll, people in this room would feel differently about this issue. The whole freedom to work place equality vote that we took, and the governor signed that bill, which basically gives people the choice whether or not they want to join a union and commission their employee. That's an issue that sends a powerful message around the country that Michigan is doing things differently. Already, because of some of the fiscal decisions we've made in the last 2 years, our Wall Street and others are kind of looking at Michigan's credit rating, and there's some real positive signs there. If businesses who are concerned that they fear a contentious labor environment, I think we're sending a message that says, you know, we aren't against unions, but we want to make sure everybody's working together for the good of the state and for the good of whatever enterprise. And it requires unions to really make the case to their members as to the value they're bringing to the table. So I supported that legislation. You know, it's a huge philosophical discussion, and, you know, I know a lot of you probably saw it. But I think it is going to send a good message around the country. Michigan is the 24th state. But there were businesses who would not come to Michigan because of fear of our labor relations. The reason I ask that is because all the bills that were introduced in the last session
December, so it'll be a new bill number, and whoever the sponsor is, that will help me track it better than the number, because that'll be a new number this term.
But I will do my eyes open that. I think that case that you're making, and you know, you get into these scope of practice issues, different professions, you know, guard their turf process, right? But at the end of the day, I think we're going to be looking at Michigan healthcare of our citizens, severe shortages of primary care doctors in Michigan, and how do we make sure that we're providing care, and I think nurse practitioners are going to play an important role in that. You know, what the exact bill says, you know, I don't know, you know what the expansions, you may appreciate you describing. Those will be kind of debated in the legislature, but I think the case would be right where you're going to have people who can't receive care because there's a sort of bureaucratic process that needs to be dedicated. Yep, no, I think it's a good point. We are trying to do more when it comes to public funds. We do every now and then here, we just make those contributions for people. We had
question, you know, how does someone do that, you know? Okay, it seems long, and I saw on TV something about New York where, so it is an area where you want to make sure we have a safety net, people are cared for, need it, but when you hear these kinds of reasons, it's, I would welcome. Well, when, and that's one of the reasons really to focus on identifying veterans, finding out what they are, kind of do in terms of their benefits. Because right now, until we made this change to the designation, we couldn't identify a veteran named in Michigan from another state. We had no record. The best they went to some institution and self-identified. So we're going to do a better job and then have people who are very knowledgeable on what they call them. State level, we can address, you know, kind of what military is that mention. But I will tell you, Adjutant General Batney and I have talked both last week and talked here today. This is a huge priority for him. He's our top tier Michigan military. And I know the governor's going to be working on this. We have veterans who, you know, are not getting the care that they earn. And then we have some who, in some way, are probably using other services and they may be using their veterans. So that is an area that we can do a better job. And we are trying to places, got a first
Well, thanks for the discussion today. I very much appreciate it.
That concludes our program. Thank you very much, and Senator, thank you for being here. Again, thanks to the Eagles for their breakfast this morning, and everyone in attendance. We'll see you at the next legislative breakfast on Friday, February 8th, which Joe will be at and be our speaker, and that's at St. Anne's Catholic Church in Eatonville. And thank you, and enjoy your day.